Right up there on top.
Trojan application that's readily available and free on the internet. This application
whole net bus. That is the most simplistic of the applications out there. It's very easy for somebody to do this. They don't have to be a computer science instructor. They don't have to be a computer science undergraduate. It could be a 10-year-old. And 10-year-olds have done this exploit. We're going to do our intrusion detection, our intrusion capability in a demonstration using our closed network. And then we're going to talk about some of the protection mechanisms that you can enforce either at the company level or at the home level to safeguard your network from these types of attacks and exploits. Next slide. Now we all know that we're living in the comfort of broadband accessibility. All of us have cable or DSL at the home or at the office network. We have T1s and so forth that stay on 24/7. While we go to sleep at night, if we leave our PC connected to the cable or DSL modem, or if we leave our machines at work connected to the network, who's safeguarding that PC when you're asleep? That's what is most vulnerable. Somebody wants to be able to attack that network and you have police activity on it. A male embedded program carrying a Trojan, if downloaded to a PC inside the network, will allow an attacker from outside that network to know it's been compromised and it will attempt to connect using that exploit. That's what our demonstration will do today. I'm pretty sure, like everyone else, we get hundreds and hundreds of emails a day. Especially the more up you are in the chain, you probably get hundreds of emails from click on this, need help, and so forth. But some of the familiar emails we get in the corporate sense is from the system administrator. And if we get an email from the system administrator that says, click on this because we need to upgrade a patch on your machine, you're probably going to click on it. And that's where the session begins. Our demonstration will show that an instant email that looks like it came from the system administrator, we're going to activate it and open the door for the attacker. These executables, these attachments that come to your machine when you click on it, run some code and they target a particular operating system, whether it be Windows 98, 95, Unix, XP, 2000. A lot of these scripts are targeting particular characteristics of the vulnerabilities known to some of these operating systems. Once this application is activated, once this application is run by the client, which is you sitting at your terminal, it will send a notification to the attacker saying, aha, I got another one. Now the attacker knows where you're at. It knows if you're online. It knows where your machine is out of the network. It's going to make its way to your machine. We're going to talk about the terminology of client-server technology. Next slide, please. In a client-server environment, when you're on your machine and you're surfing the web, you're a client. When you access a web server, when you actually access a human resources information online via server, that is the server. But if your machine becomes compromised, you run this code and now your machine is accessible to the outside world, your machine becomes a server. A lot of attackers are like that. Now your machine is serving information to the outside world. The individuals do not know that these applications are running in the background. So if I was an innocent victim and I activated this particular Trojan, I'm doing business as normal. I have no idea that in the background this application is running and allowing attackers to get into my network. And I've seen, even if you're doing Windows 2000, some of you are familiar with the 2000, or Windows XP, or Windows NT, you can see what processes are running on your desktop. This one stays hidden. It doesn't show as a process running on Windows NT, or Windows 2000, or Windows XP. That is a plus for a would-be attacker. They want that. They want that stealth mode. Just for a brief amount of time, they can get into your network. Direct connection capabilities that we have today with broadband access allows the attacker to connect to your machine from anywhere in the world. So in the past, we were looking at spam, thousands and thousands of emails coming from folks we don't know. And if we click on these email messages and we actually connect to the code, the attacker can click anywhere in the world and say, he has an email that's 1,000 people. He sends it out. He's somewhere in India, somewhere in China. He's hoping it averages somebody, 1,000, execute the code, send him a response, and now he knows it's part of that machine. Here we're going to talk about something called an IP address. That's what uniquely identifies your machine on the internet. You put it to your mailing address. Once the attacker knows that mailing address, the IP address of your machine, that's what he's going to focus on to see when you're online. Some of these detection mechanisms that we have on board our machines right now, whether at the corporate entity or at the home level, do not protect against what we call the internet, because when you execute the code inside of your network. So it thinks that you're writing regular application. You do not update a lot of the variants of NetPlus. Now, NetPlus is detectable by some of the applications out there that are current. But many of the applications that are coming out right now are different over time. So what are we talking about here with NetPlus is that network. The easiest way to get into a network. An attack would go like this. I'm going to say I have an email listing of a million email addresses. And I'm going to send each one of them, and a file says, click on this to win $1 million. I'm thinking, okay, somebody's going to respond. Well, they click on it. The averages are in my favor. Someone's going to click on it. I get the response that that individual clicked on that email. I'm now going to go to his machine, his network, and find out where he can be, his home or his business. At that point, I can do a million different things to his machine. I can make his machine an HTTP server. I can make his machine, be at home, while he's doing his serving, I can make his machine to a web server. That's what a lot of folks do. They do these types of attacks. They take an innocent person's machine at home and make them to a web server where they can upload illegal files like movies, other cracking tools, breaking the network, or information. These are numbers that they obtained from somewhere else. They'll load it up to someone's unsuspecting machine and then send that information out to their friends or friends to go to that machine, download the information. And then when, for instance, someone is notified that there's a machine out there giving out free movies, they're going to go raid that individual's house, keeping all this time unsuspecting that he was giving out files. So for instance, movies or visa information. You could also turn something on the machine that's called file sharing. You're on a cable DSL connection, like at home a couple years ago. That network, they had turned it on. The hacker went on to everyone's machine and turned on what they call file sharing. And then anybody connected to that network can now see the contents of your C or D drive. What were they looking for? They're looking for the intuitive file, quickly file. That reason has a critical bank account statement, anything they can use to log on to another site using your credentials to download information so that way they can compromise your bank account. Netbus, the characteristics of the Trojan, installed by deception. Installed by deception. And our demonstration will show that here today. Now, you're going to receive an email thinking it's coming from your system administrator, and when you click on it, you're going to open the door to the attacker. To be on a website, you're instantly clicking across the internet. If on one website says you wish to install this particular script so you can see the web page in its entirety. Thinking, okay, great, that's what I want to see. I want to find out more about sports or about some economics statistics. You click on it, nothing happens. You just open the door for the attacker getting to your network. Next slide, please. Now, what do the network administrators do to try and find out the presence of this type of Trojan or others? Well, NetBus is pretty easy. NetBus, using what they call the registry on Windows 2000, Windows 98, Windows 18, Windows XP, you can go to the registry and look for the occurrence of this information. Now, a registry is like the DNA of your machine, the Windows PC. What's loaded? What's running? This type of information, I can quickly scan and find that someone loaded up NetBus on that machine. I would immediately remove that machine from the network and clean out the NetBus from the registry that it doesn't run. This is how that particular application is able to load itself over and over again every time you reboot, because it made its way into your registry. This is why NetBus is so easy to use. This is all the client needs. The attacker needs this interface running on his machine. Clear as day button. He didn't write that, he didn't develop it. He's going to send the other portion of that program to the person he wants to hack at. And on his end, big buttons. Stuff like screen dump. Let me take a screen dump of the machine that I want to attack. So if you're working on human resources information, you have salary, visa numbers,